Jen, and welcome to the Literary Festival. This is my second event of the morning, and I'm thrilled to see you all here, but I'm really thrilled that Pulitzer Strout is here. Hello. I found her and her publicist. They were supposed to be in Italy. She's here. So I just want to, in case you don't know, which you probably do, Elizabeth Strout is a Pulitzer Prize winner. This is her fifth book, fourth book. Well, I know that there's Isabel, Amy and Isabel, and I know that she also wrote a biography, which I love. I also love the first one, and then the Burgess Brothers, and then, of course, Olive Kittredge. Thank you, Vicki. Anyway, so without further ado, with more nonsense from me, please welcome
was directly visible from my bed. During the day, the building's beauty receded, and gradually it became simply one more structure against the blue sky, and all the city's buildings seemed remote, silent, far away. It was May, and then June, and I remember how I would stand and look out the window at the sidewalk below and watch the young women my age in their spring clothes out on their lunch breaks. I could see their heads moving in conversation, their blouses rippling in the breeze. I thought how when I got out of the hospital, I would never again walk down the sidewalk without giving thanks for being one of those people. And for many years, I did that. I would remember the view from the hospital window and be glad for the sidewalk I was walking on. To begin with, it was a simple story. I had gone into the hospital to have my appendix out. After 2 days, they gave me food, but I couldn't keep it down. And then a fever arrived. No one could isolate any bacteria or figure out what had gone wrong. No one ever did. I took fluids through one IV and antibiotics came through another. They were attached to a metal pole on wobbly wheels that I pushed around with me, but I got tired easily. Toward the beginning of July, whatever problem had taken hold of me went away. But until then, I was in a very strange state, a literally feverish waiting, and I really agonized. I had a husband and two small daughters at home. I missed my girls terribly, and I worried about them so much, I was afraid it was making me sicker. When my doctor, to whom I felt a deep attachment, he was a jolly-faced Jewish man who wore such a gentle sadness on his shoulders. His grandparents and three aunts, I heard him tell a nurse, had been killed in the camps, and who had a wife and family here in New York City. This lovely man, I think, felt sorry for me, and saw to it that my girls, they were 5 and 6, could visit me if they had no illnesses. They were brought into my room by a family friend, and I saw how their little faces were dirty, and so was their hair. And I pushed my IV apparatus into the shower with them, but they cried out, "Mommy, you're so skinny." They were really frightened. They sat with me on the bed while I dried their hair with a towel, and then they drew pictures, but with apprehension. Meaning that they did not interrupt themselves every minute by saying, "Mommy, Mommy, do you like this? Mommy, look at the dress of my fairy princess." They said very little. And the younger one especially seemed unable to speak. And when I put my arms around her, I saw her lower lip thrust out and her chin tremble. She was a tiny thing, trying so hard to be brave. When they left, I did not look out the window to watch them walk away with my friend who had brought them and who had no children of her own. My husband naturally was busy running the household and also busy with his job, and he didn't often have a chance to visit me. He had told me when we met that he hated hospitals. His father had died in one when he was 14, and I saw now that he meant this. In the first room I had been assigned was an old woman dying next to me. She kept calling out for help. It was striking to me how uncaring the nurses were as she cried that she was dying. My husband could not stand it. He could not stand visiting me there, is what I mean, and he had me moved to a single room. Our health insurance didn't cover this luxury, and every day was a drain on our savings. I was grateful not to hear that poor woman crying out, but had anyone known the extent of my loneliness, I would have been embarrassed. Whenever a nurse came to take my temperature, I tried to get her to stay for a few minutes, but the nurses were busy. They could not just hang around talking. About 3 weeks after I was admitted, I turned my eyes from the window late one afternoon and found my mother sitting in a chair at the foot of my bed. Mom?
I said.
I'm Lucy, she said. Her voice sounded shy, but urgent. She leaned forward and squeezed my foot through the sheet. Hi, Mazel, she said. I had not seen my mother for years, and I kept staring at her. I could not figure out why she looked so different. Mom, how did you get here? I asked. Oh, I got on an airplane. She wiggled her fingers, and I knew that there was too much emotion for us, so I waved back and lay flat. I think you'll be all right, she added, in the same shy-sounding but urgent voice. I haven't had any dreams. Her being there, using my pet name, which I had not heard in ages, made me feel warm and liquid-filled, as though all my tension had been a solid thing and now it's not. Usually I woke at midnight and dozed fitfully, or stared wide awake through the window at the lights of the city, but that night I slept without waking, and in the morning my mother was sitting where she had been the day before. Doesn't matter, she said, when I asked. You know I don't sleep lots. The nurses offered to bring her a cot, but she shook her head. Every time a nurse offered to bring her a cot, she shook her head. After a while, the nurses stopped asking. My mother stayed with me 5 nights, and she never slept but in her chair. During our first full day together, my mother and I talked intermittently. I think neither of us quite knew what to do. She asked me a few questions about my girls, and I answered with my face becoming hot. They're amazing. I said, oh, they're just amazing. About my husband, my mother asked nothing, even though he told me this on the telephone. He was the one who had called her and asked her to come be with me, who had paid her airfare, who had offered to pick her up at the airport, my mother, who had never been in an airplane before. In spite of her saying she would take a taxi, in spite of her refusal to see him face to face, my husband had still given her guidance and money to get to me. Now sitting in a chair at the foot of my bed, my mother also said nothing about my father, and so I said nothing about him either. I kept wishing she would say, your father hopes you get better, but she did not. Was it scary getting a taxi, Mom? She hesitated, and I felt that I saw the terror that must have visited her when she stepped off the plane. But she said, I have a ton in my head, and I used it. After a moment, I said, I'm really glad you're here. She smiled quickly and looked toward the window. This was the middle of the 1980s, before cell phones, and when the beige telephone next to my bed rang, it was my husband. My mother could tell, I'm sure, by the pitiful way I said hi, as though ready to weep. My mother would quietly rise from her chair and leave the room. I suppose during those times she found food in the cafeteria or called my father from a payphone down the hall, since I never saw her eat, and since I assumed my father wondered over her safety. There was no problem as far as I understood it between them. And after I had spoken to each child, kissing the phone mouthpiece a dozen times, then lying back onto the pillow and closing my eyes, my mother would slip back into the room, for when I opened my eyes, she would be there. That first day I spoke with my brother, the eldest of us three siblings, who unmarried lived at home with my parents, though he was 36, and of my older sister, who was 34, and who lived 10 miles from my parents with 5 children and a husband. I asked if my brother had a job. He has no job, my mother said. He spends the night with any animal that will be killed the next day. I asked her what she had said, and she repeated what she had said. She added, he goes into the Peterson's barn, and he sleeps next to the pigs that will be taken to slaughter. I was surprised to hear this, and I said so. and my mother shrugged. Then my mother and I talked about the nurses my mother named them right away. Cookie, for the skinny one who was crispy in her affect. Toothache, for the woebegone older one. Serious Child, for the Indian woman we both liked. But I was tired, so my mother started telling me stories of people she had known years before. She talked in a way I didn't remember, as though pressure of feeling and words and observations had been stuffed down inside her for years, and her voice was breathy and unselfconscious. Sometimes I dozed off, and when I woke, I would beg her to talk again. But she said, "Oh, Rosalie, you need your rest." "I am resting. Please, Mom, tell me something. Tell me anything. Tell me about Kathy Nicely. I always loved her name." "Oh, yes," my mother said, "Kathy Nicely. Goodness, she came to a bad end." We were oddities, our family, even in that tiny rural town of Amgash, Illinois, where there were other homes that were run down and lacking fresh paint or shutters or gardens, no beauty for the eye to rest upon. These houses were grouped together in what was the town, but our house was not near them. While it is said that children accept their circumstances as normal, both Vicki and I understood that we were different. We were told on the playground by other children, "Your family stinks," and they'd run off pinching their noses with their fingers. My sister was told by her seventh grade teacher in front of the class that being poor was no excuse for having dirt behind the ears. No one was too poor to buy a bar of soap. My father worked on farm machinery, though he was often getting fired for disagreeing with the boss, and then getting rehired again, I think because he was good at the work and would be needed once more. My mother took in sewing. A hand-painted sign where our long driveway met the road announced sewing and alterations. And though my father, when he said our prayers with us at night, made us thank God that we had enough food, the fact is I was often ravenous, and what we had for supper many nights was molasses on bread. Telling a lie and wasting food were always things to be punished for. Otherwise, on occasion and without warning, my parents, and it was usually my mother and usually in the presence of our father, struck us impulsively and vigorously, as I think some people may have suspected by our splotchy skin and sullen dispositions, and there was isolation. We lived in the Soft Valley area, where you can go for a long while and see only one or two houses surrounded by fields, and as I have said, we didn't have houses near us. We lived with cornfields and fields of soybeans spreading to the horizon, and yet beyond the horizon was the Peterson's pig farm. In the middle of the cornfield stood one tree, and its darkness was striking. For many years, I thought that tree was my friend. It was my friend. Our home was down a very long dirt road, not far from the Rock River, near some trees that were windbreaks for the cornfields, so we did not have any neighbors nearby, and we did not have television, and we did not have newspapers or magazines or books in the house. The first year of her marriage, my mother had worked at the local library, and apparently my brother later told me this, loved books. But then the library told my mother the regulations had changed. They could only hire someone with a proper education. My mother never believed them. She stopped reading, and many years went by before she went to a different library in a different town and brought home books again. I mention this because there is the question of how children become aware of what the world is and how to act in it. How, for example, do you learn that it is impolite to ask a couple why they have no children? How do you set a table? How do you know if you are chewing with your mouth open if no one has ever told you? How do you even know what you look like if the only mirror in the house is a tiny one high above the kitchen sink? Or if you have never heard a living soul say that you are pretty, but rather as your breasts develop, you are told by your mother that you are starting to look like one of the cows in the Peterson's barn. How Vicki managed to this day, I don't know. We were not as close as you might expect. We were equally friendless and equally scorned, and we eyed each other with the same suspicion with which we eyed the rest of the world. There are times now, and my life has changed so completely, that I think back on the early years and I find myself thinking, it was not that bad. Perhaps it was not. But there are times too, unexpected, when walking down a sunny sidewalk, or watching the top of a tree bend in the wind, or seeing the November sky close down over the East River, I am suddenly filled with a knowledge of darkness so deep that a sound might escape from my mouth, and I will step into the nearest clothing store and talk with a stranger about the shape of sweaters newly arrived. This must be the way most of us maneuver through the world, half knowing, half not, visited by memories that can't possibly be true. But when I see others walking with confidence down the sidewalk, as though they are free completely from terror, I realize I don't know how others are. So much of life seems speculation. The thing about Kathy, my mother said, the thing about Kathy was, my mother leaned forward in her chair and tilted her head with her hand to her chin. Gradually, I saw how in the years since I had last known her, she had gained just enough weight to cause her features to soften. Her glasses were no longer black, but beige, and the hair beside her face had turned paler, but not gray, so she seemed a slightly larger, fuzzier version of her younger self. The thing about Kathy, I said, is that she was nice. I don't know, my mother said. I don't know how nice she was. We were interrupted by the nurse Cookie, who walked into the room with her clipboard and then held my wrist and took my pulse, gazing into the air, her blue eyes far away. She took my temperature, glanced at the thermometer, wrote something on my chart, and walked out of the room. My mother, who had been watching Cookie, now gazed out the window. Kathy nicely, she said, always wanted more. I often thought the reason she was friends with me, oh, I don't know if you could call us friends, really. I just sewed for her and she paid me. But I've often thought the reason she would stay and talk, well, she did have me over to a place when her troubles arrived. But what I'm trying to say here is that I always thought she liked my circumstances being so much lower than her own. She couldn't envy anything about me. Kathy always wanted something she didn't have. She had those beautiful daughters, but they weren't enough. She wanted a son. She had that nice house in Hanson, but it wasn't nice enough. She wanted something closer to the city. What city? That's how she was. And then plucking something from her lap, squinting, my mother added in a lower voice, she was an only child. I think that had something to do with it. How self-centered they can be. I felt the cold shock, cold hot shock that comes from being struck without warning. My husband was an only child, and my mother had told me long before that such a condition, as she put it, could only lead to selfishness in the end. My mother went on, well, she was jealous. Not of me, of course. But for example, Kathy wanted to travel, and her husband wasn't like that. He wanted Kathy to be content and stay home, and they would live off his salary. He did well. He managed to farm corn, feed corn, you know. They had a perfectly nice life. Anyone would have wanted their life, really. Why, they went to dances at some club. I've not been to a dance since high school. Kathy would come to me and get a new dress made just to go to a dance. Sometimes she brought the girls over, such pretty little things and well-behaved. I always remember the first time she brought them over, Kathy said to me, may I present the pretty nicely girls? And when I started to say, oh, they're lovely indeed, she said, no, that's what they're called at their school in Hanston, the pretty nicely girls. Now, how does that feel, I've always wondered, to be known as a pretty nicely girl? But once, my mother said in her urgent voice, I caught one of them whispering to her sisters about something in our place smelling funny. That's just kids, Mom, I said. Kids always think places smell funny. My mother took her glasses off, breathed on each lens briskly, and cleaned them with a cloth of her skirt. I thought how naked her face looked then. I could not stop staring at her naked-looking face. And then one day, you know, she said, the times changed. People think everything went foolish in the 60s, but it wasn't until the 70s, really. Her glasses returned. Her face returned. My mother continued. Or maybe it took that long for the changes to find their way to our cow patch. But one day Kathy came to visit. She was giggling and strange, girlish, you know. You'd gone off by then, too. My mother raised her arm and wiggled her fingers. She did not say school. She did not say scholar, college. And so I didn't say those words either. My mother said, Kathy fancied someone she'd met. That was clear to me. Though she didn't come out and say so, I had a vision. A visitation, it would be more accurate to say. It came to me as I sat there looking at her, and I thought, I saw this, and I thought, uh-oh, Kathy's in trouble. And she was, I said. And she was, my mother said. Kathy nicely had fallen in love with the teacher of one of her children, who were all three in high school by this time, and she began to see this man secretly. Then she told her husband that she had to realize herself more fully, and she couldn't do it trapped by domestic chains. So she moved out, left her husband, her daughters, her house. It wasn't until she called my mother weeping that my mother learned the details. My mother drove to find her. Kathy had rented a small apartment, and she was sitting on a beanbag chair, much skinnier than she used to be, and she confessed to my mother that she'd fallen in love. But once she moved out of her house, the fellow had dropped her. Said he could not continue with what they'd been doing. My mother, having come to this point in the story, raised her eyebrows as though the puzzlement of this was large but not unpleasant to her. Anyway, her husband was furious, my mother said, and humiliated me, would not take her back. Her husband never took her back. He went for over 10 years without even speaking to her. When the oldest girl, Linda, got married straight out of high school, Kathy invited my parents to the wedding because, my mother surmised, Kathy had known at the wedding who would speak to her. That girl got married so quickly, my mother said, speaking rapidly now. People thought she was pregnant, but no child arrived that I ever heard about. And she divorced him a year later and went off to Beloit, I believe, looking for a rich husband, and I think I heard she found one. My mother said that at the wedding, Kathy kept flitting around, desperately nervous. Oh, she said, it was a sad thing to see. Of course we didn't know Saul, and it was obvious she just about hired us to be there. We sat in the chairs. I remember on one wall of the place, you know, it was the club, that silly fancy place in Hanston. And they had all these Indian arrowheads under glass. Why was that, I wondered? Why don't you care about all those arrowheads? And Kathy would try and talk to some person and come right back to us. Even Linda, that's it up in white, and Kathy had not asked me to make the gown. The girl went out and bought it. Even this bride girl hardly gave her mother the time of day. Kathy's lived in a little house a few miles from her husband, ex-husband now for almost 15 years, all alone. The girls stayed loyal to their father. I'm surprised when I think about it, that Kathy was even allowed at the wedding. Anyway, he never had anyone else. He should have taken her back, I said, tears in my eyes. I suppose his pride was hurt, my mother shrugged. Well, he's alone now, and she's alone, and one day they're going to die. True, my mother said. I became distraught that day over the fate of Kathy nicely, while my mother sat at the foot of my bed. At least I remember it that way. I know that I told my mother with a lump in my throat and my eyes singing that Kathy's husband should have taken her back. I'm quite sure I said, he'll be sorry, I'm telling you he will. And my mother said, I suspect she's the one who's sorry. But maybe that wasn't what my mother said.
An audio tape for the last week, and I have to say I think it's probably one of your best books so far.
Well, thank you.
And my question is, as a writer,
Yeah. Let's
say you've done a bunch of writing for the day. Are you the type, do you like to go back and fix the typos and make it like kind of presentable before you move on to the next part of the story? Or what is your process like? Do you go zooming through the end or do you stop and fix it a little bit as you go along?
Well, that's a good question, and I don't go zooming through to the end because I don't write from beginning to end. I never have. I don't write anything from beginning to end. And I don't fix typos because I'm very, very messy. And I write by hand. I start things by hand. And I just start writing I think of them as sketches, but they're just little tiny pieces of scenes. So I might have started perhaps with one tiny conversation with the mother, you know, just a slice of a conversation with the mother and the daughter in a hospital. And I would write that up and I'd push it aside. And so I have a really big table that I work on, and it's really very messy. And, you know, I like mess. It's taken me years to realize I actually really am comfortable in mess. I don't need dirt, you know, but mess. And so, and then I'll write another one, and then I'll write another one, and then at some point I'll type them up, a few of them, and see how they look, and mess that up as fast as I can, you know, with my pencil. But, and that goes on for a while, and then eventually, in the case of Lucy Barton, I actually was working on something else at the time, but I would write these little sketches, and they kept coming around the table, and I realized, this is a voice I have to listen to, because there is a very distinct flavor for me to her voice, and so eventually I realized, okay. And so I focused on more scenes. But the typos I leave until the very, very end. <'Cause, you know. laughs> Thank you. Yes.
Yeah. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about your relationship.
relationship with Lucy Barton. I really enjoyed the book. I thought you were very psychologically astute in the way that you portray her. And so I'd just like to hear your comments about your relationship with Lucy.
Right. My relationship with Lucy grew. And like I said, once I realized from those sketches that I was going to have to listen to this voice, once I accepted, because it was a first-person voice, and I have not written in first-person, except for the prologue to the Burgess voice, which nobody remembers, but, I haven't written in first-person for, a million years, maybe a short story 1,000 years ago, but, so that was daunting to me because I'm not used to it, and because I understood that there are certain problems with first person. You can only see from that one, blah blah blah. But when I realized that I could start by looking back and put some retrospect into it, that was helpful for that problem. But in terms of Lucy, my relationship with her grew, and it grew pretty quickly once I allowed myself to hear her voice and to write her voice in the first person. And I loved her. I love almost all of my characters, but there was something about Lucy that she touched my heart. And that's, I don't know if that's helpful, but.
And her mother.
Her mother touched my heart as well. Yes.
You mentioned that when you were writing the little bits and pieces of Lucy Barton, that you were working on something else. Are you working on that still or again? And can you tell us about it?
I can't.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
I don't know how I got to tell you about it. Ostracized because he was that poor. And I don't believe, it wasn't probably until I was halfway through, not the beginning to the end, but halfway through the mess, that I realized, oh, right. And I remember he sat in front of me in third grade, and I remember the third grade teacher said to him in front of the whole class, "You have dirt behind your ears, and there is no one who's too poor to buy a bar of soap," and that poor kid's face, his neck just turned bright red. He never spoke. So I think there was something in me that wanted to give an expression to that family, and they are everywhere, and they're probably more so now. But they exist, and they don't have a voice. And what is that like? So that, I think, was the impulse for Lucy. Now, the space that I work in, mostly I work in New York, and mostly I work at our dining room table, which is big, and then either push the stuff over at night or put on the floor. But so I work at home, and I've almost always worked at home. But recently, in the last few years, I do have a place in Maine that's all mine, a studio in Maine, and that's wild. I've never had a whole place for myself, and I work very well there. And that also has a big table and a couch, because you know I like to like it. Yes.
And I'm wondering if the telling of this story is pointing out, that illness. I was very puzzled over why no one could be sure of what it was. Is it post-traumatic stress disorder from his childhood hers? Why is it important for anyone to be able to determine that?
Right. Well, the first question about the illness, I left it deliberately ambiguous because I love ambiguity, because I think life is just, we just never know things in life, I think. There's so few things we just don't know. We think we know, but we don't know. So I left that ambiguous. She had a fever, and then it went away. And they, back then, I mean, now I'm sure they would have sent her home with the fever. But back then, people could stay in the hospital until she could keep the food down. So that's always been open to whatever the reader wants to bring to it. And the first remark about my name is Lucy Barton. I'm glad you mentioned, because I think sometimes people don't realize when she first meets Sarah Payne in the clothing store, Sarah Payne can barely say her name. And so that's what, as Lucy grows throughout the book, by the end, and she says, you know, this is my roommate's story, it's mom's story, but it's my story, and my name is Lucy Barton, because she's taking agency over her own story. So, thank you.
I'd like to ask about Ollie Kittredge, and whether when you were writing that, you did it in the same way, doing sketches, and whether any of those sketches, as you look back on them now, were related to things in your life.
Related to things in my life?
Mm-hmm.
I did work on it the same way, sketches. That's how I've seemed to have worked most of my writing life, with these little pieces. So, yes, as far as I can remember, that's how I wrote all, but I certainly didn't write that from beginning to end. I never wrote any of those stories from beginning to end as well. Were they related to my life? I don't think they were, although everything that a writer lives through or observes, and I've always kept my eyes open, I've always watched, and I've always listened a lot. And I just seem to be able to absorb details. I can't remember huge things, but I remember small things a lot. And so I think many of those things made their way into all. For example, the story Starman, where Harmon is sitting by the marina and there's a young couple. That young couple, I saw them on the subway probably 6 years earlier. And I just remember, all of a sudden I remembered as I was writing about Harmon standing there, and I thought, okay, here's a young couple. And I just remembered this young couple I saw on the subway. She was sitting on his lap. The girlfriend was sitting on the boyfriend's lap. She was so adorable. God, they were so cute. And she was saying, stop sniffing me. I know you're sniffing me. And I just thought, oh, God, she's so adorable. And she had the same denim jacket with the fur that I made this girl, but then I made the girl sick. That's my story. I don't think the girl I saw was there. But that's the kind of thing. I mean, you give me that as an example of things that will come back.
Hi.
read the book about 3 months ago, and the first thing that really struck me was the accessibility of the voice. It was like, I mean, here if you read it, it's even more so, but it was just so easily to engage with. But the question I had was, there's a scene with Sarah Payne, and I can't remember the details of, in which Sarah Payne talks about the relationship of fiction and narrative, and she kind of lectures someone about, you know, not always look like people were asking, this is a part of your life.
Right.
She really addresses that issue in the book, and I wish you could comment on that, because I felt it was a really pivotal moment in the book.
I think that's where Sarah Payne's at the public library,
and
so, and she's written a scene where, in one of her books, she wrote a scene about a president who was senile, and his wife ruled the country with astrology charts, so she gets hate him. And so, you know, and they kept saying, but what do you feel, what do you feel? And she finally said, well, I feel, you know, she finally owns up and says, if I, Sarah Payne, as a citizen of this country, I feel that the woman I made up lets him up easily, but she, up until then, kept saying, it's not, and the man asked, do you answer these letters, these hate letters? And she said, no, it's not my job as a fiction writer to make the distinction between the narrative voice of the writer and the writer. And I feel the same way. I feel that the narrative voice that a writer has is just that. It is the narrative voice that we find to tell the story that we want to tell. And of course, we will be in that story in many ways, because we're the people making up the material, and yet it should not be confused with the person, because it's the voice for the story. So. Yeah, sure.
I read Olive Kittredge a few years ago. I haven't read Lucy Barton. In the middle of Amy and Isabel. And I just, this is more of an observation. You said you love all your characters. And I was trying to pinpoint in my mind, what is special about the way you're writing? And to me, that is right up there. I'm Fat Bev and these people in the mill. I mean, you love them, and I just want to thank you for that.
Thank you. She's so fabulous. Thank you. Yeah. I once in a while I think, oh, I wrote, you know, there might be a character that comes by. I realize that I might not have been as generous hearted about that person, but mostly I feel like a lot of them, I sure love that.
Believe it or not, I have a Hollywood question.
Yeah.
How did you feel about Frances McDormand representing Oz?
Yeah, I thought she did fabulous. Right.
Yes, I have a question about your writing process.
Yeah.
When you write, do you go back and forth from, like, say, you're in the middle of the story and then you need to go back into the beginning or change things around? Is that the way that you
sometimes
work?
Yes. I go all over the place.
Yeah.
I just go all over the place. For many, many, many months, it goes back and forth, and then I'll realize, oh, well, if I have this here, then we'll set that up in the beginning, or, you know, so it's a constant back and forth, and then finally, toward the end, I do sit down, and I say, you know, say, okay, let's start from the beginning, and tie this in a string that's as tight as it can be to the end. But that's after really years of just making a mess, you know? And there's a few years of panic in there as well, to be honest, because, you know, you make enough mess and don't
But it always works out. So there's the panic, but I go wherever my mind goes is what I do. Because here's the thing, it's like if I sit down and say, okay, well I have to get so and so from the car to the grocery, you know, whatever, then it will be wooden because I'm doing it because I feel like I need to get her. And you'll feel that it's wooden because it's wooden. So I just don't write that. I just don't write it. I'll write it in the store and I write it in the car. Yeah. And then whatever. And so I've learned those in-between things are just, you know, if there's not life behind what I'm writing, then it will get dumped on the floor pretty quickly. So if there's not a human impulse, then maybe. And so that's why I go back and forth to wherever I find that human impulse.
Hi, Elizabeth. I'm up here from New Hampshire with Karen. I want you to know you are beloved in your home state. We claim her. And I wanted to also ask you, how do you come up with your beats? You give us a break just taking off the glasses, and is that something that happens as you're writing, or do you go back and say, we need a breath here? And also just to thank you, because I don't know if you heard Diane Ring this week, if you listened to them talking about your book, but... what I realized listening to that and reading your books myself is you're so good at the exact right detail and also allowing us space to interpret. I love that you make things ambiguous and you trust us as readers. But I wanted to know if that happens on revision. Do you go back and think, I need this beat, I need this detail, or is that happening?
You know, what's very important to me is sound. How something sounds. It's like I'm always looking for the right sound to convey the story to you, the reader. And the reader is very important to me. So I'm always thinking all along, especially toward the end, but I'm always thinking, like, what does the reader need? Does the reader need this? No. Does the reader need this? Yeah. Let's say the reader needs this. And so I'm always trying, like, with one eye to be the reader and with one eye to be the writer. And it's sort of this back and forth thing almost all the time. That's as much as I can try and explain that in terms of where the beat comes and where, you know, the details that are chosen. And they do change. The details do change, you know, as I work on that piece. But I'll think, oh wait, that's not needed. But this one is. And so, yeah.
Okay, so we're going to have to stop the questions here. We really want to thank everybody who asked questions. Really,